Hells up, y'all. It's popping. It's D. About to react to this vid by Patrick CC. It's titled, Why is Gordon Ramsay Always Angry? Okay, we're about to get to the root of the problem. We're about to analyze his behavior, pay attention to the signs, and we are going to diagnose him. Okay, we're going to be his psychiatrist, his psychologist, all of that. That's what people tend to do on the internet anyway, so let's do it together and be fake therapists. Let's watch.
Because of shows like Kitchen Nightmares and Hell's Kitchen, we know that Gordon Ramsay is kind of a jerk. Many people attribute Gordon's antics to a fake persona that he displays for entertainment. It's just a character, they say. However, when you consider the violent and abusive life Gordon had to endure, you will understand where his rage comes from. Gordon's father, Gordon Ramsay Sr., was a violent alcoholic who Ramsay described as a hard-drinking womanizer. When his father was drunk, he'd either hit the children or throw things around the house. We had to run for our lives, he recalled. We spent many nights, weekends, hidden in the Department of Health and Social Security rooms. Although his father abused and neglected his children, his mother, Helen, suffered the most. She was beaten relentlessly, even when she was 7 months pregnant with Gordon's younger sister. Gordon and his siblings, Diane, Ronnie, and Yvonne, often sat cowering upstairs in their bedrooms while their mother was subjected to physical abuse downstairs. She often feared one day he might kill her. Gordon was already bigger than his father by the age of 12, but he never fought back. I don't know if I could ever have hit him. We were never big or strong enough to stop him. He had power over all of us. The crazy part is, the kids often spent time in Child Protective Services. Police would take their father away during his outbursts, but it was only temporary, as they would eventually return under the same roof as him. They could not escape. To make matters worse, Gordon's father didn't even support the family financially. His mother was a career nurse, and his father just worked various dead-end jobs. Dad would often have a fallout with someone at work and get fired. And because our home often came with his job, we would become homeless and have to move again. The family lived in roughly 16 different homes across England before settling in Warwickshire. As you can imagine, Gordon's education was negatively impacted due to his father's terrorizing presence. However, he found a positive outlet detached from his home life through football. He was aggressive on the field and could sprint really fast, which landed him a spot on the Rangers Football Club youth team. Gordon claims that he was scouted at one of his games by an Oxford United manager, which led him to being signed to the team. But an Oxford spokesman says otherwise. We don't have concrete evidence that he ever played for Oxford United, and none of those coaches around that time can remember him playing for us. This seems like a strange thing for Gordon to lie about, but nevertheless, football was a major passion of his. It was also around this time that Gordon was finally able to flee his father's abuse for good. His mother told Gordon and his sister Diane that tension in their relationship was worse than ever. She forced them to move out of the house for their own safety. At age 16, Gordon and Diane moved out and got their own flat together in Banbury, located in Oxfordshire, southeast England. But at age 19, Gordon's dreams of being a football player were destroyed, which was the best thing that would ever happen to him. After suffering a serious knee injury, Gordon enrolled at North Oxfordshire Technical College to study hotel management. During this time, he worked as a commis chef at the Roxton House Hotel. The commis chef, otherwise known as a junior chef, is at the bottom of the food chain, literally. Most kitchen brigades are organized similarly to the military. Auguste Escoffier is credited for coming up with this hierarchy system while serving as a cook in the French military in the 1800s. Commis chefs help ensure that a kitchen's operations run smoothly. They perform cooking, cleaning, delivery, and other support duties as instructed by the chef de partier. After progressing through the ranks and becoming the sous chef, Gordon ran the kitchen and 70-seat dining room at the Wickham Arms until he started a sexual relationship with the owner's wife.
I slept with the boss's wife because she made, a go for me. I mean, what 19-year-old chef, fit as a fiddle, is going to say no to a stunning 33-year-old wife of your boss?
So yeah, he got fired. However, his experience would land him his first job at a Michelin star restaurant and his first appearance on television. Michelin stars are basically the highest badges of honor for restaurants. The stars are part of the Michelin Guide, which employs thousands of inspectors who travel around the world sampling the finest cuisine. These highly trained inspectors will visit hundreds of restaurants a year.
I hate when they visit a restaurant because they always hike up their prices once they get that star. It's like, all right, calm down.
In order to identify the best of the best. Michelin inspectors are always anonymous to ensure they don't receive preferential treatment during their meals. Inspectors book, dine, and pay for their meals in the same way as an average guest. Once each restaurant in consideration has been inspected, the Michelin guide director meets with the worldwide teams for what is called star sessions, where the rating of each restaurant is debated. These sessions often last days, with each establishment considered one by one until a unanimous decision is reached. Restaurants can earn a maximum of 3 stars. Michelin quantifies 1 star as being high quality cooking worth a stop, 2 stars for excellent cooking worth a detour, and finally, the prestigious 3 stars represent exceptional cuisine worth a special journey. Ramsay honed his culinary skills at Harvey's in Wandsworth. This is where a legend was created. The executive chef at Harvey's was Marco Pierre White, who is not only world-class, but also considered to be the first celebrity chef. Marco has been rumored to have somewhat of a temper. He has admitted that sometimes he shouts and screams in the kitchen. Gordon says that Marco was brutal, allegedly one night even making a young Gordon Ramsay cry. However, this side of him is rarely seen when the cameras are on. On TV, he's more of an intense savage that struck fear into you without saying or doing too much.
No, I didn't make Gordon Ramsay cry. He made himself cry. That was his choice to cry.
After working at Harvey's for 3
What he said?
Been making a young Gordon Ramsay cry. However, this side of him is rarely seen when the cameras are on. On TV, he's more of an intense savage that struck fear into you without saying or doing too much.
No, I didn't make Gordon Ramsay cry. He made himself cry.
That's wild.
That was his choice to cry.
After working at Harvey's for 3 years, Ramsay became more equipped to handle the fast-paced and high-pressure trade of fine dining. He also probably learned that sometimes to run a kitchen, you need to be aggressive, loud, and dominant. The 1988 documentary Marco shows a behind-the-scenes look at the chaotic life in the kitchen. Gordon is seen multiple times throughout the documentary, calm, listening, learning, and getting a taste for what it was like to be on the big screen. Sadly, his family was still suffering. Gordon's sister Diane decided to return home to live with their parents. One day, their father threw scalding hot milk over their mother, who was in bed, punching and dragging her downstairs. Diane got her mother to the hospital, where they were referred to Women's Aid, a charity in the United Kingdom aimed at ending domestic violence against women and children. The pair found refuge in one of the charity's shelters for 6 months and got help sorting out Helen's benefits. Her husband had never given her any money, likely a tactic he used to ensure she would never leave. Helen and Diane went home to find the flat ransacked and a postcard in the mantelpiece warning, "One night when you're least expecting it, I'll come back and finish you all off." From that moment onward, the Ramsay family was finally free of Gordon James Sr. By his mid-20s, Gordon had already built a resume that would land him jobs working alongside world-class chefs in France, and then as head chef at La Tante Claire in Chelsea, a 3-Michelin-star restaurant. However, Marco White would present something that would stamp Gordon's legacy permanently. In 1993, Marco offered Gordon a head chef position and a 10% share in the Rossmore. The restaurant was renamed Aubergine and achieved Michelin star status 14 months later. Gordon's cooking was so highly sought after that the restaurant had a waiting list of up to 6 months and bills averaging about 75 euros per person. By 1997, Aubergine won its 2nd Michelin star. Despite the restaurant's success, a dispute began between Ramsay and the business owners, who wanted to expand and turn Aubergine into a chain restaurant. Gordon didn't feel he could duplicate his cooking as a formulaic concept like most chain restaurants do. After many years of disagreements and legal battles, Ramsay announced his departure and handed in his notice. The entire staff at the restaurant followed Gordon and participated in a walkout. Ramsay later referred to it as Black Friday. He described the decision to set out on his own as the most important day of my entire cooking career, the most important decision of my life. Gordon decided to purchase and open his own restaurant called Restaurant Gordon Ramsay in Chelsea in 1998. The journey of opening his business venture paired with a television documentary series called Boiling Point. The series only had 5 episodes, but gave viewers a raw, behind-the-scenes look at Ramsay and his element. Along with his cooking methods and expertise, he tried to impress food critics in hopes of a 3rd Michelin star. Although the series was short-lived, Ramsay's vulgar language and hostile nature were on full display, and he quickly became known for his loud mouth and short temper in the kitchen. This guy got fired.
I feel like that's how you know that's how he is. People who say he's playing a character, he wasn't playing no goddamn character in the beginning right here. He probably did start to, like, you know, play it up a lot and, like, put on extras as time went on, and he got, you know, all of his other shows and shit just to entertain people. But this clearly him at the core. We see why. So stop with the excuses. He's a character completely. He's a super nice guy. Oh, you know this nigga, you got his number. You go to his house on Sundays to eat. Shut up.
Drinking water.
Standing in front of the fucking glass, drinking fucking water. In front of all the customers. Fuck off.
I can't hydrate. The fuck?
But even exactly with these explosive moments, it still feels tame compared to what would come many years later. After establishing his first restaurant, Ramsay expanded and opened several restaurants across the United Kingdom. He earned his third Michelin star in 2001, making him the first Scottish chef to achieve the feat and securing him a lifelong legacy at the age of 35. His second TV show portrayed Gordon in a much more genuine and humble way. Ramsay's Kitchen Nightmares was a 2004 show where Gordon visited failing restaurants and helped to improve the establishments in just 1 week. He then revisited the restaurants months later to see how each business fared in his absence. Kitchen Nightmares was a huge commercial hit. Ramsay initially came off as quite relatable. He was very candid, but still supportive in a positive manner and genuinely wanted to see businesses succeed. He used his time wisely, learning the staff's strengths and weaknesses and the town's culture surrounding each restaurant. He also used collective plural pronouns like we when describing each restaurant and what needs to be done, fully integrating himself as a part of the team and part of the solution, not merely operating as an onlooker giving directions. This Ramsay made for far more compelling television and left viewers excited about the food and entrepreneurship. The more poise and calculated attitude carried on to his next televised culinary show, Hell's Kitchen UK. The show created a competition between two kitchens, featuring 10 aspiring chefs competing for a prize of €250,000, money that the winner could use to start his or her own restaurant. They were split into two teams of six, one celebrity chef, along with five members.
And just look at the difference. Now, what are we going to do? Right, can we taste now, please?
That's
the worst risotto.
Oh, thank you, boss.
That is shocking.
Now, I'm trying. I'm my hardest, chef.
Oh, man. Risotto was hard to make. I tried to make it once. It was cool.
Due to the show's success, Gordon worked with the Fox easy, Network to produce an American version with the same name. First premiering in 2005, Hell's Kitchen US followed a different format. This is where Gordon's asshole persona was formed.
Oh, you want to yell at the Americans, but she was a little bit easier on the other niggas in the UK. Interesting. He did say this one was in the UK, right?
Now, cut back on your section.
Fine, because I'm not a quitter.
You're not a quitter. You're not a fucking cook either. Move your fat ass. You donkey! You're fucking useless, you know that. You're cooking in a burnt pan, you fucking fucking donkey! Don't let him cook a fucking thing!
The US version of Hell's Kitchen surpassed the UK version in popularity. The show was significantly more dramatic than any of Gordon's UK shows, with the addition of loud sound effects, dramatic music, rapid jump cuts, and exaggerated drama.
Your special has now become not very special. Thanks to Face
Chef. This is probably where he paid.
Yeah, but I'm not Face Chef.
Yes, say that again.
I said I'm not Dick Face
Chef.
You're
pissed, are you? Look at me in the eyes! Not as pissed as I am! You fucking are! Donkey!
It became so excessive that people online started accusing the producers of staging fake drama for more entertaining television. People also claimed that the editors used editing techniques to make certain contestants appear as poor performers to justify their elimination later. The most obvious example was the case of Amanda Tech Moore, who you can clearly see cooking here, but the only problem is that she was eliminated 3 episodes earlier. Essentially, they're using old footage of contestants, for example, Gordon yelling at someone in episode 1, to justify their elimination in episode 10, even if they didn't do anything wrong that day. Since the show is not premiering live and viewers wouldn't be able to notice the difference. Another major controversy in regards to the show being staged occurred when contestant Joseph Tinnelly from season 6, during one elimination round, angrily confronted Ramsay, challenging him to a fight, before being escorted off the set.
You want a jacket? You want to talk some sh**? Let's go step outside, woman. I ain't here for that, dog.
The incident drew criticism from viewers suggesting the scene was potentially fake and conducted to add more drama and tension to the show to increase viewer interest. However, it was this tumultuous persona that may have ruined his UK television presence.
Okay, this was asked for, well done. I'm especially sending it back.
And let me just tell you something. You know, in terms of well done, look, we braised it. What is that?
That's well done.
That is well done, so stop doing this shit!
What about this, Gordon?
That is well done!
About this.
It's well done!
Without the added sound effects and intense music, Gordon's screaming looks less performative, which made viewers think he was actually just a jerk. But the USA audience couldn't get enough of Gordon. He was a rock star. He worked with the Fox Network again to produce an American version of Kitchen Nightmares. First premiering in 2007, Kitchen Nightmares US followed the exact blueprint as the original, as the owners invited Gordon to spend a week with a failing restaurant to revive the business. However, like the US version of Hell's Kitchen, Kitchen Nightmares was more dramatized and featured Ramsay displaying a visibly short temper, regularly yelling profanities, and insulting his staff. Gordon once even said the F word 298 times in just two episodes. When you saw those two Kitchen Nightmares condensed into one, last year when they had those 298 fucks, I wasn't proud of that. There's come a time when, at the age of 43, I'm getting a bit tired of the foul-mouthed bully chef. In that same interview, Ramsay was adamant in his refusal to pander to elderly British viewers by trying to act like anyone other than himself. So on one hand, he admits he isn't proud of his excessive outbursts. On the other, he isn't just gonna act like a proper lad to please his UK audience. Plus, in 2017, he came out with a show called The F Word, so I don't think he really cares that much. Both versions of Kitchen Nightmares produced 7 seasons and were cancelled collectively in 2014. As of September 2021, Ramsay has accumulated a net worth estimated to be around $220 million, with an estimated salary of $225,000 per episode. Gordon typically earns roughly $45 million per year from his media and restaurant business. His shows account for more than 75 hours of programming and more than $150 million in ad sales for Fox. With restaurants in the UK, US, France, Italy, China, South Korea, and Qatar, his empire has expanded on a global scale. Evidently, being a kid pays pretty well. But Gordon is also able to act like this because he has started at the very bottom and grinded for decades mastering his craft. These days, you can see him on TikTok telling people how terrible their cooking is. Whether his rage comes from his father's abuse or from the perspective of a passionate teacher wanting his pupils to learn, it never gets old seeing Gordon Ramsay absolutely destroy someone's cooking.
That nigga said, I didn't make him cry, he made himself cry. He made the choice to cry. That is so fucked up. I can't. I mean, he's been through a lot, as we all have. We all been through some shit. There ain't no excuse to, you know, be rude to people. But people make it excuses all the time or whatever, I guess. But yeah, I feel like this really debunks the whole sentiment that, oh, it's just a character, just a character. He was not playing no goddamn character in that first documentary. Like, they were just documenting him running the restaurant and shit. He's being his most authentic self, I would argue. Even though there were cameras there, I just feel like he was just being himself. And even as Patrick described, he said it was real, it was raw. I feel like he's probably typically an ass. That's just who he is. But he definitely played it up for, you know, Kitchen Nightmares, Hell's Kitchen, and all that, for entertainment value. And it works because he's very entertaining. I like him. What was I about to say? Oh, I heard his food ain't even that good. He got a couple restaurants in Vegas, and I've heard from a few people that it was just it was just whatever. I'm gonna go try it out myself though and see. I think his Hell's Kitchen is out there. I think he has another place too. I think he got like a burger spot or something. I don't know. I'll figure it out. I will be in Vegas in a few months. Anyway, y'all, let me know what y'all think. Let me know what other videos you're gonna watch, and I'll see y'all the next one. Bye.